So, specifically pertaining to thyroid, difficulties in airway control are expected at three levels. They can be supraglottic, that is above the level of vocal cords, or can be glottic at the level of vocal cords, or infraglottic, that is at the level of trachea. First and foremost, coming to the history taking, duration of disease, which is very important as we all know, because long-standing swellings, long-standing and large swellings, they are associated with more incidence of tracheomalacia. Similarly, history of compressive symptoms on trachea, esophagus and adjoining structures, which may manifest in the form of dyspnea, stridor, hoarseness or dysphagia. History of trauma and burns to airway, neck and radiotherapy is also as well important because they may distort the airway anatomy and they may also cause fibrosis and making some external manipulating maneuvers that we most often use in difficult intubation cases, they become difficult. History and presence of OSA is as well important because the presence of OSA is as a independent predictive factor for difficult mask ventilation as well as for difficult intubation laryngoscopy. History of associated chronic diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis, diabetes, spondylitis with limited joint mobility, they can cause limited joint mobility in temporomandibular joint and neck extension. Previous anesthetic records are as well important. They are one of the most important factors predicting the difficult intubation. So a global examination, as we do in all the cases, irrespective of the type of surgery, it includes the basically the patency of the nares. Like any prior information about any masses in the nasal cavity, it helps to in prevention of any nasal bleed and deviated nasal septum. The prior knowledge of any presence of any deviated nasal septum helps us in selection of nares for nasal intubation. Mouth opening, as we all know, more than three fingers is considered adequate for difficult for normal laryngoscopy. Prominent upper incisors impose prominent upper incisors obviously impose more prominent upper incisors, as we all know, cause difficulty in laryngoscopy and intubation. Palate, as we all know, a high arched palate or a long narrow mouth may cause difficulty in laryngoscopy. Similarly, if the inability to protrude the lower jaw beyond the upper incisors can cause difficulty in introduction of the laryngoscope blade and further intubation. Observation of the patient's neck is as well important. As we all know, presence of short, thick neck, any masses in the neck or restricted neck mobility can impose restrictions for difficult laryngoscopy. Now coming to the pertaining to thyroid, the examination we are going to the systematically coming first of all to supraglottic factors, which directly affect the laryngoscopy and intubation, include mouth opening. As we all know, if the mouth opening is less than specifically two fingers, may cause difficulty in laryngoscopy and intubation. Tongue size as compared to oral cavity or size may cause difficulty. Submandibular space, basically it is assessed with the help of thyromental distance and hyomental distance, which we will be discussing later in further slides. Head and neck mobility, as we all know, the normal head and neck mobility, the patient is if there is restriction any neck mobility, the patient won't be able to make the sniffing position and might cause in difficult laryngoscopy. Similarly, obesity and neck circumference are independent predictors for difficult laryngoscopy and intubation. Factors concerning glottis level, they are basically related to cord paresis or paralysis. Like long-standing swellings, they cause transient paralysis of recurrent laryngeal nerve. And position of the vocal cords. Like position of the vocal cords, they can be problematic when we are intubating the patient and if the cords are emitters or abducted positions, and they might cause impingement in tube advancement. Now coming to infraglottic airway factors. The infraglottic airway factors, they are basically related to the examination of the thyroid swelling. In infraglottic factors, we are basically assessing the extent of the swelling, size of the swelling, the whether we are able to get below the lower margin of the thyroid swelling. Because all these factors, they affect the deviation and compression of trachea and the presence of tracheomalacia. All these factors we will be discussing in detail in the further slides. So, in general, the examination specifically related to thyroid swelling, the following points should be kept in mind, like body weight, height and BMI of the patient, any protruding maxilla, any presence of any protruding or retrognathic mandible, the nature and extent of swelling, and assessment of neck movement in all the planes, especially atlantoaxial flexion and extension. Estimation of thyromental distance, presence of any compressive symptoms like dyspnea, stridor, dysphagia, presence of any engorged veins on neck, on upper thorax, and as we all know, positive Cocker's test, which indicate compression of trachea when we push a lateral lobe of the thyroid causing stridor, and similarly positive Pemberton signs. There are a number of battery of objective tests which are described for predicting difficult laryngoscopy and intubation. Among these objective tests, some of the important ones that we are practicing in daily day-to-day life, we'll be discussing later. So there are predictors of difficult laryngoscopy and intubation. We have some individual indices, which include some physical examination indices, some radiological indices, and some advanced indices. Among group indices, we have some named indices. Basically, these group indices are a collection. These basically involve a group of individual indices grouped together with a scoring given. Now, coming to some detailed assessment of the airway, individual indices among, first of all, discussing about the assessment of cervical and atlanto-occipital movement. The normal neck flexion that is required is 25 to 35 degrees, and normal atlanto-occipital joint extension that is considered appropriate is 85 degrees. So for assessing these movements, we tell the patient to look at the ceiling without frowning the eyebrows, and if the patient is able to do that, then we can say the patient is having normal extension. Next flexion, we will tell the patient to touch the chin to the manubrium sternae. If he is able to do that, it means the patient is having normal, we can consider the normal neck flexion. This position is called the sniffing or the Magel's position. So accordingly, if there is a reduction in atlanto-occipital extension, if there is two-thirds limitation of extension or there is complete extension, then they are considered for predictors for difficult laryngoscopy. Similarly, we have another test called mandibular protrusion test, in which if the patient is not able to protrude the lower incisors beyond the upper incisors, or it cannot bring the lower incisors edge to edge with the upper incisors, then that is considered as one of the difficult predictor for laryngoscopy and intubation. Similarly, we have some tests for assessment of the mandibular space. This space determines how easily we are able to align our laryngeal and pharyngeal axis when the atlanto-occipital joint is extended. Mandibular space assessment can be done in by two parameters. We have one is thyromental distance, and another is hyomental distance. For thyromental distance, as we all know, distance is measured from the upper edge of the thyroid notch to the chin with the head in fully extended position. And if distance is less than 6 cm, laryngoscopy can be difficult, and in those cases, maybe some external laryngeal manipulation may be required and might help in intubation. The similar parameter, another similar parameter is hyomental distance. If the distance is less than 4 cm, laryngoscopy is mostly impossible, and intubation is also going to be difficult. Intrincisor gap, as we all know, normal value should be at least, it should admit 3 finger breadth or should be greater than 5 cm. Sternomental distance, as we all know, from the manubrium sternum to the tip of the mentum with the neck in fully extension and the mouth closed. Minimum value should be at least 12.5 cm. Considered as one of the best predictors for difficult laryngoscopy and intubation. Now, there are some tests for assessing the adequacy of the oropharynx for laryngoscopy and intubation. The most widely used, we have Malampati grating. It indicates the amount of space in the oral cavity to accommodate laryngoscope and ET tube. It has sensitivity of 40 to 80%, specificity between 60 to 80%. Basically, it has 4 gradings, among which class 3 and class 4, in which we are not able to see all of the oropharyngeal structures. In class 3, we are able to see only the ovular base, soft and hard palate. In class 4, only hard palate is visible. So basically, class 3 and 4, they are going to be a predictor for a difficult laryngoscopy as well as intubation. And they basically signify that the angle between the base of the tongue and the laryngeal inlet is more acute and it's not conducive for easy laryngoscopy. Limitation of MMP grading is that poor into observer reliability and limited accuracy. So, in a summarized form, the direct laryngoscopy is expected to be difficult in patients if they are having Malampati grade 3 and 4, restricted mouth opening less than 2 cm, thyromental distance less than 6 cm, and a Wilson angle of neck movement if it is less than 80 degrees, BMI if it is greater than 40, and neck circumference if it is greater than 50 cm in obese patients. Now, after the supraglottic airway assessment, we have glottic wing during laryngoscopy for assessment of glottic wing during laryngoscopy. We have indirect mirror laryngoscopic view, which we invariably use in almost all cases here for undergoing thyroid surgery. And for direct laryngoscopic view, we have a comic Lehane grading and percentage of glottic opening scoring system. Comic Lehane grading, it is basically divided into 4 grades. This is the first picture showing the grade 1, in which we are able to visualize the whole of the glottic opening. In the second picture, basically we are able to see the posterior commissure and arytenoids are visible. In the third picture, only epiglottis is visualized, and in fourth picture we are not even able to visualize the epiglottis. So grade 3 and 4, they are predictors of difficult laryngoscopy. In these cases, there might be some external manipulation might be required, might help in intubation. Similarly, we have a percentage of glottic opening scoring system. If the entire glottic aperture is visualized and it's 100%, if we are not able to visualize any of the glottic structures, then 0%. Coming to the investigations part, a reduction in the space between the C1 spinous process and the occiput, if it is less than 5 mm, when seen on a lateral neck x-ray taken in the neutral position, it is an indicator of difficult intubation. Lateral neck x-rays, they can help in detecting any foreign bodies, any nature and level of the obstruction, any presence of soft tissue swelling, or presence of any tracheal compression and deviation. Like in pre-operative x-ray assessment, we have some pictures of lateral neck x-ray showing a large swelling causing compression of the trachea. And in this AP view, we can see the deviation of the trachea towards right side. So tracheal compression, we can say if it is more than 30% tracheal lumen narrowing, considered as tracheal compression, and tracheal deviation of more than 1 cm, considered significant to cause respiratory problems. CT scan is required for better visualization of deviation or compression, and in case of suspicion for infiltration by the tumor. these are some pictures depicting deviation of the trachea to the right side. And the details about these radiological investigations will be dealt on later by Dr. Zafar. Tracheal compression is defined as reduction in tracheal lumen to less than 15 mm as seen on CT scan, and if it is less than 5 mm considered as critical tracheal compression. Ultrasound can also prove useful in intubation by measurement of various parameters, which include tongue thickness, pretracheal fat at the level of vocal cords, and the ability to visualize the hyoid bone. Basically, the ability to visualize the hyoid bone is done by sublingual ultrasound, but that is not validated on a larger scale. Nasoendoscopy can be useful for examining the upper airway anatomy by identifying abnormalities such as upper airway swelling, any anatomy distortion, or the significance of any periglottic lesions. Flow volume loops, the patterns seen on flow volume loops depend on the site of the tracheal compression. Like if there is any supraesternal compression, the pattern seen can be extrathoracic pattern, and if there is infrasternal compression, then we can see the intrathoracic pattern. Like if there is any fixed tracheal infiltration by the tumor, it basically manifests as fixed obstruction in which both the inspiratory and expiratory limbs of the flow volume loop are affected. If the obstruction is extrathoracic, then basically inspiratory limb is affected. And if there is the swelling is infrasternal, then present is intrathoracic in which expiratory limb is affected. But flow volume loops are not as good predictors of difficult intubation as CT, because they are basically taken when the patient is in supine position and at the maximum inspiratory and expiratory efforts. So CT, we can say, are better predictors of difficult intubation. So finally, I want to conclude that no single airway test can provide a high index of sensitivity and specificity for prediction of difficult airway. Even in cases where we have a proper airway assessment of the patient, still we miss, still they are going to be we can have any unanticipated difficult airway. So we should have a pre-formulated and practiced plans for airway management in the event of an unanticipated difficult airway. Thank you.